Hi, very good morning. I am Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. All my video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. In continuity with the previous lectures, today we'll be discussing on one of the very interesting topic, very frequently can be asked as a full question in your fourth year exam. In theory as well as oral exam also, and you will see lot number of cases in your everyday practice, that is hyperlipidemia or dyslipidemia. Dyslipidemia means abnormal level of lipids, maybe high, maybe low, but hyperlipidemia means elevated level of lipids. And when you say hyperlipoproteinemia, that is elevated level of lipoproteins in blood. We'll be discussing at the end of the lecture regarding some of the guidelines which will be advised in a person with dyslipidemia. We'll be talking mainly on management, drugs, guidelines, etc. But before we go to the management of dyslipidemia, we are going to talk regarding what is lipids, what are the abnormal things, etc. So little idea regarding lipids. So there are few words which we have already mentioned. Hyperlipidemia means presence of elevated level or abnormal level of lipids. When you say hyper means elevated level of lipids in blood. When you say lipoproteinemia, hyperlipoproteinemia means elevated level of lipoproteins in blood. And when you say dyslipidemia means abnormal level of lipids, maybe elevated, maybe low. So this will be some of the terminology. So dyslipidemia means presence of abnormal level of blood lipids, maybe lipids or lipoproteins. And it is diagnosed by using fasting lipoprotein profiles. And by and large, you come across in majority of the people some abnormality in lipids, and it is one of the cause for atherosclerosis. So dyslipidemia are the disorders of lipoprotein metabolism that results in either high level of total cholesterol or high level of non-HDL cholesterol or high level of LDL or low level of HDL or high triglyceride. Any one of these abnormality is labeled as dyslipidemia, but basically it is a disorder of lipoproteins. So it is an abnormality in the lipoprotein, either LDL, HDL, or we call non-HDL groups, and maybe elevated level of triglycerides. So those are the common abnormality which you will see in a dyslipidemia. So hyperlipidemia means increased concentration of cholesterol or triglyceride in blood. So lipids are two types, cholesterol and triglyceride. And cholesterol can be a good cholesterol we call HDL, and bad cholesterol is LDL, VLDL, triglycerides, which you derive from triglyceride will give rise to VLDL, lipoprotein A, etc. Those are called bad cholesterol. So you can use the word, if triglyceride is elevated, we call hypertriglyceridemia. If cholesterol is elevated, we use the word hypercholesterolemia. And when both are elevated, we call combined hyperlipidemia. And in some disorders, you might have abnormality in other lipoproteins like HDL low level or lipoprotein A abnormalities. So these are some of the things, and this is a major risk factor for atherosclerosis. So you can have a mixed hyperlipidemia, hypertriglyceridemia or hypercholesterolemia. And if you look at the composition, so chylomicron contains major part of triglycerides, and density wise it is low, but size wise it is large molecule. While VLDL, TG becomes little low and you have got a cholesterol ester. In intermediate, the cholesterol ester becomes more, triglyceride level in that particular is low. then S cholesterol ester becomes much more in LDL, which is much, much more than triglyceride. We call high level of bad cholesterol. And in HDL, usually you have got a cholesterol level little higher as compared to triglyceride. And density wise, it is high density, but size wise, it is a small. And this is called as a high density lipoproteins. So chylomicron and chylomicron remnants, VLDL, intermediate density lipoproteins, low density lipoproteins, and lipoprotein A. These are all atherogenic. These are all atherogenic. So that we call as atherogenic lipoproteins. While HDL is good cholesterol. So these are all atherogenic. And we usually label them as non-HDL cholesterol. So chylomicrons, VLDL, IDL, LDL, lipoproteins. But chylomicron will give rise to formation of VLDL, and then it will be converted into IDL, will be converted into LDL, and then finally into HDL. So this, all this VLDL, IDL, LDL, and lipoprotein A, they are called bad cholesterol, or we call atherogenic lipoproteins. So VLDL will be made in liver. It will be converted into IDL, which will be converted into LDL, and then lipoprotein A, and finally HDL. These are all atherogenic, or we call as a non-HDL cholesterol, which are highly atherogenic. So we label them as a good cholesterol. HDL is labeled as a good cholesterol. LDL is a bad cholesterol. VLDL is considered as a ugly, and very bad is lipoprotein A. It is also called as a deadly cholesterol. This is a standard chart which tells you which are optimum level, borderline high risk and very high risk. As far as total cholesterol is concerned, less than 200 is optimum. Borderline high is between 200 to 240. More than 240 is high risk, and more than 300 will be very, very high risk. LDL less than 100 is optimum. Borderline high is between 130 to 160. High risk will be between 160 to 190. More than 190 is considered as a very high risk. As far as HDL is concerned, low level will be high risk. So less than 40 is considered as a high risk. But optimum level required is more than 60. Between 40 to 60 is considered as borderline high. But less than 40 is definitely abnormal, and it is high risk. Triglyceride less than 150 is good. But between 150 to 200 is considered as borderline high risk. Between 200 to 500 is considered as high. And more than 500 is considered as a very high risk. So these figures are important. But now the target has changed depending upon the other calculated risk factors. So normal lipids, we consider non-HDL cholesterol. Normal should be between 130 to 180. But if it is more than 200, it is definitely very high risk. But ideally, non-HDL should be less than 130, we call good. If we bring it down to 100, and if it is brought down to less than 70, it is considered as best, or we call the best. And now there is a target of 55. Non-HDL should be 55 in very, very high risk group of people who are already having an atherosclerotic complication, we call AS, CVS. So atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications. So in those particular group, in a very high risk group, the target is set down to 55. As far as the ratio is concerned, usually very few person undergoes this ratio, LDL divided by HDL. we want to bring down LDL and HDL should be elevated. So ratio should be reduced. In normal, the ratio is between 2.5 to 3.5. And when it goes above 5, it is a very high risk group. If you bring it down to less than 2, it is good. If you bring it down to less than 1.5, it is very good, or we call the best. And further you reduce it to very, means if you bring HDL to 75 and LDL to less than 75, it will become less than 1. And then it is considered to be the best. And now that is the target. As far as total cholesterol to HDL is concerned, same way. You have to reduce TC and elevate the HDL. So you have to bring down that ratio. Same thing is with ApoB to ApoA. The ratio should be less than 1. So if it is more than 20, it is a bad. Means ApoB, if it is less than 20, it is normal. More than 20, it is high. So if the ratio is more than 30, it is definitely a high risk. Now, as far as the etiology is concerned, hyperlipidemia we divide into two big groups. We call primary or familial or genetic, which is consisting of only 5% of the group of people, while secondary group is 95% of the people. And most common cause in everyday practice we come across is 95. But don't forget those primary group also. So primary group we will not be discussing in detail. We'll be having one slide possible. But secondary group is very common, which will be very frequently the most common cause is diet, particularly high fat diet, diabetes, type 2 diabetes, obesity, cardiometabolic syndrome, chronic alcoholism, person on a drugs like beta blockers or hydrochlorothiazide in a higher dose, nephrotic syndrome, chronic liver disease, cholestatic jaundice, oral contraceptive pills, myxedema. These disorders comes topmost on the list. So 5% is congenital, while 95% is secondary groups. So you will come across a primary group which can be pure triglyceridemia or maybe pure hypercholesterolemia or maybe mixture of the two. And in good number of people, you will come across low HDL level. And in secondary, we have already mentioned the most common group is hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, excess of steroids, alcohol, high carbohydrate, high fat diet, or also in case of a nephrotic syndrome. But in nephrotic syndrome, the cholesterol level will be much higher, while in all these groups, triglyceride level will be elevated. Mixed variety group is diabetes mellitus, glucocorticoid, hypothyroidism, and nephrotic syndromes. That comes topmost on the list. Triglyceride level and TC ratio, if it is more than 5, you will label that as hypertriglyceridemia. By and large, a person will have a triglyceride more than 500. So that is very, very common. So if a triglyceride level is very, very high, more than 500, some person can have even up to 1500, etc. Those are isolated familial hypertriglyceridemia. And when TG to TC ratio is less than 5 and total cholesterol is more than 300, we label that as isolated hypercholesterolemia. And in that particular condition, the LDL level will be very high, more than 190. These are called isolated hypercholesterolemia. They are very, very common in familial variety, or we call primary group or congenital or genetic groups. So there will be type 1 is chylomicron elevated, so we call hyperchylomicronemia. Type 2A is hypercholesterolemia, where there is an elevated level of LDL. In type 2B, it is an elevated level of LDL with VLDL because of increased TG, that is called familial combined hypercholesterolemia. These two are quite common. Type 2A and type 2B are very common. You can have another variety called type 3, where you got a beta, broad beta, VLDL being elevated, which is because of familial dis-beta lipoproteinemia. Type 4 is because of elevation of only triglyceride, which is very high, which gives rise to VLDL being very, very high, where LDL level is not elevated. So this is familial hypertriglyceridemia. So indirectly, Type 2A is familial hypercholesterolemia. Type 4 is hypertriglyceridemia. And type 2B is mixed variety, where you have got a LDL plus triglyceride being elevated, which will elevate VLDL level. While type 5 is a mixed picture, where you have got a chylomicron plus VLDL being elevated, means the person will also have a triglyceride level will be also elevated. So that is a mixture of type 1 as well as type 4. So commonly that will be the group which is being divided by WHO organization. And this is a Fredrickson classification in case of a primary dyslipidemia. Elevated LDL level you will come across because of diet, because of some drugs, common nephrotic syndromes, cholestatic jaundice, hypothyroidism, obesity, pregnancy, etc. This is very, very common, where LDL level is markedly elevated. While triglyceride level will be elevated, more common in a person with a low, very low fat diet. He is taking high intake of refined carbohydrate, excessive alcohol intake, particularly in oral contraceptive pills, glucocorticoids, nephrotic syndrome, CKD, and diabetes mellitus. This will be some of the common conditions where triglyceride will be elevated in secondary groups, and this will be secondary group as far as LDL level elevation is concerned. Most common cause for dyslipidemia is dietary cause, excess of high carbohydrate, high fat diet. These are all responsible for hypercholesterolemia and hypertriglyceridemia. We call as hyperlipidemia. Definitely responsible for hyperlipidemia. We call diet. I am not going into detail. Whatever you take, digested, goes to small intestine. From that, chylomicron absorb. Then it will be, chylomicron will be converted into chylomicron remnants. And you will have a free fatty acid liberated out. And that will be by lipoprotein lipase. You will have a free fatty acid going to adipose tissue and muscle for utilization. Remnant of chylomicron will be delivered to liver, and in liver it will be converted into endogenous cholesterol, and that endogenous cholesterol will be thrown out in some quantity in a bile, and liver will produce VLDL. That VLDL in periphery, that is in the capillary, will be converted by again lipoprotein lipase. Free fatty acid will be liberated out, that will be utilized by adipose tissue and muscle. And now after that free fatty acid separation, VLDL will be converted into intermediate low density lipoprotein, intermediate density lipoprotein, that will be picked up by liver, will be converted into LDL, and that LDL by extrahepatic tissue will be converted into HDL. And this LDL, if it is oxidized, will be picked up by macrophages and will be deposited in a blood vessels below the intima, and we call that as atherosclerosis. Metabolic syndrome will be a very, very high risk for cardiovascular disorders. You will have a type 2 diabetes, impaired glucose tolerance, hypertension, insulin resistance, obesity. Person can have a polycystic ovarian syndrome, PCOS short form we call, hyperuricemia, hyperinsulinemia, decreased fibrinolytic activity, dyslipidemia where TG will be high, LDL will be high and HDL will be low. And person will be very, very prone to develop rapidly progressive atherosclerosis. So person will have a progressive atherosclerosis. So insulin resistance will give rise to hypertension, obesity, hyperinsulinemia, diabetes, hypertriglyceridemia, high level of LDL, also small and dense lipoproteins, low level of HDL, and there will be increased hypercoagulability. All these factors will be prone to develop atherosclerosis and cardiovascular complications. HDL has got a pleiotropic effects, vasodilatory activity, anti-inflammatory activity, antioxidative activity, anti-apoptotic, endothelial repair. It reverses the cholesterol transport and removes the cholesterol from atheromatous plaque, and it reduces the size of atheromatous plaque, and also anti-infectious activity. All these are pleiotropic benefit. So HDL is considered as the best cholesterol or good cholesterol. So higher the level of HDL, the reversibility of atherogenesis will take place. And this will be all additional advantage of HDL cholesterol, elevated level of HDL cholesterol. This lipidemia, particularly in a variety of congenital and in some cases of acquired group, particularly cholestatic jaundice, you will have eruptive xanthomas, mainly because of high level of TG. You will have xanthomas, particularly because of a high level of cholesterol. You will have a deposition of xanthomas over the tendon, we call it a tendon xanthomas, which will be because of severe elevated level of LDL cholesterol, and it is very common in familial hypercholesterolemia. Very, very common. These are different varieties of eruptive xanthoma, tendinous xanthoma. This is xanthalasma. This is again tendinous xanthomas. This is xanthalasma. This is corneal arcus or arcus sinalis. And because of hypercholesterolemia, you will have atherosclerotic occlusions. This will be xanthomas. This is again xanthoma, arcus sinalis. You will have a deposition along the tendon, we call it a tendinous xanthomas. This will be deposition over the tendons, very commonly over tendo-acheli. So these are all the depositions. You will have a high level of triglyceride as well as high level of cholesterol level, particularly LDL cholesterol. And that will end up with atherosclerosis. It can produce acute coronary syndrome, unstable angina, STEMI, non-STEMI, aneurysm, congestive heart failure, hypertension. You can have a sudden cardiac death, stroke, peripheral arterial disease. These are all the outcome of progressive atherosclerosis. So this is a diagram showing you progressive atherosclerosis. And end result are these complications. So these are the common complications which can take place, like stroke, aneurysm, angina, myocardial infarction, hypertension, peripheral arterial disease, peripheral vascular disease, etc. This will be some of the most common. And artery involved can be any big size artery to a medium size artery. They are more commonly involved, including even coronary artery and renal artery. As far as a hypertriglyceridemia is concerned, you can have a primary genetic factor like familial hypertriglyceridemia or secondary factor, particularly classical example, type 2 diabetes mellitus. And that can give rise to good number of complications, particularly pancreatitis. Don't forget this. A person with a hypertriglyceridemia, if presents with an acute pain in abdomen, don't forget to look for acute pancreatitis, which is one of the cause of acute pancreatitis is hypertriglyceridemia after gallstone and alcohol. So it can be acute pancreatitis, abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, amylase will be elevated, and you will have a pseudo-hyponatremia also. And most common with diabetes, alcohol, obesity, pregnancy, as well as don't forget gallstones. Investigation in hyperlipidemia or dyslipidemia, clinical examination for eruptive xanthomas. In case of a hypertriglyceridemia, person can present as an acute abdomen, weight gain, uncontrolled type 2 diabetes, metabolic syndromes, get a history of oral contraceptive pills, beta blockers, hydrochlorothiazide, alcohol, hypertension, obstructive jaundice, nephrotic syndrome, obesity, cardiometabolic syndrome. This will be clinical examination. By and large, fasting lipids is important. But if fasting is not available, you can get a random sample also and calculate non-HDL cholesterol. So anytime in a fasting, TC should be below 200, LDL should be less than 100, TG should be less than 150, and HDL should be more than 60. These are required level, but depending upon the risk factors. Now the targets are lower down tremendously. Those are the targets. So for those targets, you will have to put them on a treatment. We call lipid lowering drugs. To find out the type 2 diabetes mellitus, you will have to go for GTT or you can call HbA1c fasting PP. To rule out myxedema, TSH. Ideally free T3, T4 and TSH. Liver panel to rule out liver disorders. Renal function test can also produce, say nephrotic syndrome can have hyperlipidemias, particularly hypercholesterolemia. So renal function test is also important, and liver disorders can also have hyperlipidemia, particularly cholestatic jaundice. To find out the effect of atherosclerosis, ECG, echo, TMT, and you might require even angiography to find out the amount of coronary artery involvement. And do not forget the familial variety of hypercholesterolemia and hypertriglyceridemia groups. That is type 2A, type 4, type 2B. These are three very common. So look for those. And there are a good number of other investigations which will help you to find out early atherosclerosis, like carotid intima media thickness, aortic carotid plaque by MRI, we call cardiac scan, cardiac MRI, coronary calcium score, ankle brachial index, then vasoreactive ultrasounds, then pulse wave velocity, etc. can be utilized. All this to detect atherosclerosis as early as possible, you can utilize. And there are a lot of other risk factors which are responsible for atherosclerosis. You should also look for those factors also. So there are some non-invasive measurement for atherosclerosis. We have already mentioned flow-mediated dilatation, nitroglycerin-mediated dilatation, brachial artery diameters, intima media thickness, plaque measurements, pulse wave velocity, ankle brachial index, ankle brachial index after exercise, etc. All these are non-invasive techniques. You try to find out as early as possible how severe or how much is the involvement of peripheral arteries. And most simple is ABI is very, very easy. So that is the best, and another very common carotid intima media thickness measurements. Those are quite common. Another non-invasive technique is we call as cardiac MRI, which is non-invasive. So cardiac MRI is quite important. In India, we find typical Indian trial we call, where TG is very high, HDL is very low, and lipoprotein is elevated. So it is called triad. So high TG, high lipoprotein A, and low HDL is very classically seen in Indian groups. Now we are going to the management part. In management part, diet and exercise cannot replace anything. So in all people, diet and exercise is a must. And in that particularly, we will not be going into detail regarding a diet, but we'll be giving a little highlights. And exercise is a must. Along with that, we call lifestyle modification, particularly stop smoking, stop alcohol, avoid sedentary lifestyle, etc. They are all important. And also simultaneously, stop beta blocker, stop hydrochlorothiazide, stop oral contraceptive pills which are responsible for hyperlipidemia. As well as, person should be treated for the basic etiology like myxedema, obesity, cardiometabolic syndrome, etc. All those should be also treated simultaneously. As far as the drug therapy is concerned to reduce the lipids, we call lipid lowering drugs, of which the most common which is being utilized is called hydroxymethyl glutaryl coenzyme A reductase inhibitor, short form we call HMG coenzyme A reductase inhibitor, we call statins. So it is called HMG CoA reductase inhibitor, and this is the most common we call as a statin groups, while all other are called non-statin therapy. So statin is the main pillar for treatment of reducing LDL, and it will help little bit to elevate HDL. There is another compound we call as a fibric acid derivatives, we call fibrates, and those are mainly for reducing TG, that is triglyceride. Nicotinic acid preparation we call nicine, and that is mainly utilized to for elevation of HDL. There is another compound called as ezetimibe that is mainly utilized as an additional factor along with statin to reduce LDL and TG. So it is used as an add-on therapy to statins, but it is a non-statin compound. It is not acting at the level of liver. Bile acid resins are not commonly utilized, and one of the compound which is utilized is cholecalciferol. And there is other two compounds, probucol, PCSK9 inhibitors, and there are others. We'll be mentioning some of those at the end of those slides. But the most common which are utilized, there are three common, that is we call statin, niacin, ezetimibe and fenofibrates. These are the four groups of compound most commonly utilized for as a lipid lowering drugs, and we'll be talking of those four compounds. So any person who is at risk, so calculate the risk and determine the management groups. Means you will have to find out which type of abnormality, whether it is primary, whether it is secondary, and what type. It is triglyceride, it is LDL, it is HDL low, or it is combined, etc. Lifestyle therapy is must in all. And you have to start with statin. And with that, you try to monitor the patient. And in monitoring of the patient, you look at the lipid level, you look at the side effect of drugs, and you also look at the complication because of atherosclerosis. Means we call as a atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications. And then, if you go up to maximum dose or maximum tolerable dose of statin and still you do not meet the target, now you will have to add what we call as a non-statin therapy, which may include ezetimibe or maybe fibrates groups or maybe niacin groups, any one of these. And still after that, if you don't reach the targets, then you go to the PCSK9 inhibitors, etc. We'll be mentioning some of those. So there is something called as the ABCD approach for any person who are at very high risk. So along with diet, exercise and physical activity, that is diet and exercise, so we call lifestyle modification, plus you give lipid lowering drugs, that is cholesterol and dyslipidemia treatment, you have to control the blood pressure, control of diabetes, and plus you have to add aspirin as well as we call as an antiplatelet drug, maybe a mono or dual antiplatelet therapy depending upon the risk. So this is called ABCD approach, commonly being utilized in any person who are at high risk of dyslipidemia with hypertension and complication because of atherosclerosis. So we divide the drugs into first group we call statin, we call HMG coenzyme A reductase inhibitor, and which will include statin, and among statin, atorvastatin, and rosuvastatin are the two most compound commonly being utilized in everyday practice. While fluvastatin, lovastatin, pravastatin, simvastatin, etc. not frequently being utilized. While fenofibrates, it is belonging to non-statin groups. Niacin is again non-statin groups. Bile acids, sulcastrum are again non-statin groups. And cholesterol absorption inhibitors are also non-statin groups. And that compound is ezetimibe. And we have got also one called CETP inhibitors. These are all non-statin groups. That is fibrates, niacin, CETP inhibitors, bile acid sequestrum, and ezetimibe. But the most common which are being utilized in everyday practice is statins, fenofibrate groups, niacin groups, and ezetimibe. Another which are being utilized, but you have to use in a larger doses, like omega-3 fatty acids, which is derived from fish oil and it is containing EPA and DHA. You can utilize the plant sterols and you can utilize CETP inhibitors. Basically, we are utilizing three common groups. We call statin, niacin and fibrates. But nowadays, ezetimibe is also one of the group which is as an add-on therapy to statins. Niacin is mainly for HDL and fenofibrate is mainly for TG. But for further lowering of LDL, ezetimibe is utilized as an add-on therapy over statin groups. So this is a one good slide which is showing you where the drug is effective. Dietary restriction and exercise, or we call lifestyle modification, is absolutely must. When you use ezetimibe, it is acting on the GI tract. So it will be acting at the level of GI tract. This is dietary. 2 is acting at the GI tract, which will be reducing the absorption of cholesterol from GI tract. 3 will be acting on this enterohepatic circulation. 3 will be acting at this level. 4 will be acting on the liver. 5 will be VLDL secretion inhibitors, that is niacin. That will be here, the liver output. And TG, that is 6 fenofibrate, will be acting, that is conversion of VLDL. That is TG reduction, that is fenofibrates. And CETP inhibitors will be acting at this level, that conversions of TG into LDL. So that will be acting at that level. So if you take this particular gut, and this is that hepatocytes. So in hepatocytes, HMG coenzyme reductase inhibitor will be working, that is statin. Niacin will be working where cholesterol conversion to VLDL will be blocked, while ezetimibe will be acting at reabsorption from gut and delivering it to liver. So ezetimibe will be acting at a gut level, while statin will be acting in the liver cells. Niacin will be acting in conversion of a cholesterol into VLDL. And that is also will be acting at the hepatocyte level. And bile acid sequestrum will be acting at the enterohepatic circulation. So these two, that is ezetimibe and bile acid sequestrum, they will be acting outside the liver cells. While statin and niacin will be acting at the level of liver cells. This is one. This is ezetimibe is 2. This is bile sequestrum is 3, niacin is 4. So those are the in liver statins. Other is niacin. This is one. Ezetimibe absorption from gut, delivering it to liver. That is ezetimibe. Now we are going to statins. Statin will help you to reduce LDL as much as up to 55%, while TG will be reduced maybe right from 7 up to 30%, and it will elevate HDL minor only 15%. So it does not take part much in elevation of HDL, but main is reduction of LDL and partial reduction of TG. Now, when the statin are given in a larger doses, the chances of myopathy and damage to the muscles are very common, where your CPK enzymes will be elevated and you can develop myopathy. So if a person who is on a large dose of statin, if they start complaining of muscle pain and muscular weakness, do keep it in mind of myopathy. Examine, look for CPK enzyme level, and if they are markedly elevated, stop statin and switch over to other lipid lowering drugs. Also, there is an effect on liver, and you can have a liver enzymes being elevated, and it is absolutely contraindicated during pregnancy. So these three things you have to keep it in mind. Side effects wise, myopathy and hepatotoxic, and as far as contraindication is concerned, main during pregnancy, it is absolutely contraindicated. While in a severe liver disease, particularly chronic liver disease, cirrhosis, portal hypertension, in those conditions, it should be avoided. Now, it is found to be beneficial in reducing LDL, by which it will help in all atherosclerotic complications like coronary artery disease, atherosclerotic complication like hypertension, particularly following a CABG or we call as a coronary intervention PCI for reduction of strokes. So it is utilized as primary prevention as well as secondary in those groups. So statins, well tolerated. Myalgia is quite common. GI disturbances, that is abdominal pain, diarrhea, is also common, but that can subside. Occasionally you can get insomnia and rash, but serious side effects are hepatotoxic, where your SGPT will be elevated. You can get rhabdomyolysis, that is damage to the muscle, and you can develop even myopathy. Particularly this rhabdomyolysis will be elevated if statin is combined with fenofibrate. So whenever a person is on statin with fenofibrate for reduction of TG, you must pay attention to muscle complication. An absolutely rare complication is angioedema. Not very common. Absolutely rare. So indication is primary prevention, secondary prevention. So you can utilize that as the chief main drug for primary and secondary prevention in all atherosclerotic complications. We already mentioned main contraindication is pregnancy and severe liver disorders. Also, it is also one of the drug for Alzheimer's disease, and they also use in a prostatic cancers. And by and large, as maximum activity of HMG coenzyme reductase is during night, so it should be given at bedtime. So statin should be given as much as possible at bedtime only. Avoid giving during a daytime. So you get the best effect if it is given at the bedtime. There is additional pleiotropic benefits, particularly because of nitric oxide effect, beneficial effect on endothelium. So it improves the endothelial function. It decreases the endothelial adhesiveness by reducing in inflammation. It reduces the endothelial fibrinolysis. So, it increases the TPA activity. So, endothelial fibrinolysis is increased, and it decreases the platelet aggregation. These are all pleiotropic effects. We have got atorvastatin and fluvastatin are synthetic statins, while Prava, Simva, and Lova are natural statin. But the most common which is being utilized is atorvastatin and rosuvastatin. They are synthetic preparations, and they have got little amount of pleiotropic benefit apart from cholesterol lowering. So do keep it in mind. There is an additional benefit of those statins. So apart from lipid lowering, improves in endothelial function, reduction in vascular inflammation, reduction in platelet aggregation, increased neovascularization, increase in circulatory endothelial progenitor cells, stabilization of atherosclerotic plaque, hence it is utilized in an acute coronary syndromes, unstable angina, also for peripheral arterial disease, all those conditions. It has got also little amount of antithrombotic action. It enhances the action of TPA by increasing the fibrinolysis. It protects against sepsis. It inhibits the germ cells migration during development, etc. Hence, it is contraindicated during pregnancy. It has got also immune suppressions and it has got osteoclast apoptosis. Hence, it increases the synthetic activity of osteoblasts. These are the additional benefit what you can come across. So, pleiotropic benefits. Benefits because of cardiovascular disease, stroke, primary and secondary preventions. But side effects wise, hepatotoxic, rhabdomyolysis, angioedema, and during pregnancy, those are bad side effects or bad side of statins. Otherwise, statin is a wonderful drug for lipid lowering, particularly LDL cholesterol, slight elevation of HDL, and slight reduction of TG. Now we go to the second big group we call fenofibrates. There are two types, clofibrates, gemfibrozil and fenofibrates. These are called paroxysome, proliferator, activated receptor. So PPAR gamma receptors, that is being acted upon by this particular compound. So activating lipase, hence increases the hydrolysis of TG in chylomicrons and VLDL particles, and by which it helps in reduction in TG level. So it will reduce hepatic VLDL production. It will increase hepatic uptake of LDL, and it will suppress release of free fatty acids from adipose tissue. So these are the main action, as well as it inhibits the synthesis of TG in liver. So this, all these four actions will help in reduction in TG level, and also it will help in reduction in VLDL level as well as LDL level. Sorry, there will be slight increase in LDL level. An increase in secretion of cholesterol in the bile is also increased by users of fenofibrate. So there will be also reduction in little amount of cholesterol. So there is a slight reduction in LDL. Increase in HDL level, slight. But there is a marked decrease in TG, right up to 50%. Average 30. LDL increases 10% to 35%, not much increase. But by and large, not much increase in HDL. But in LDL, there is a modest decrease, only 5 to 10%. Very rarely, up to 20%. So major action, reduction in TG, lowers TG by almost 20 to 50%. It raises HDL by 10% to 20% maximum, and LDL reduction is slight only. But good number of time, along with reduction in TG, there is a slight elevation of LDL level with high TG particularly. So do remember, whenever you are giving fenofibrates, you can have a slight elevation of LDL. So fenofibrate alone should not be given. Always it is given with statin. But other aspect of it, whenever you give it along with statin, do keep it in mind, myopathies. So myopathy is very common when it is utilized along with statin. You can have a formation of gallstone, which will be very common because cholesterol will be thrown into bile. So chances of cholesterol stones will be higher. GI dyspepsia is quite common. Diarrhea is another common. Nausea can be there. Blurred vision. And increased risk of gallstones, particularly pigmentary stones. Prolongation of prothrombin time can take place. So you require a liver parameters at regular interval. So statin plus fibrates, you have to keep something in mind. Use statin alone for non-HDL goal. By and large, use a fish oil or niacin rather than phenofibrates for additional reduction and elevation of HDL. Keep the doses of the statin and phenofibrate as low as possible. Dose of phenofibrate in the AM and statin in the PM ideally should be separate. Avoid combo preparation in renal impairment. So any person with renal dysfunction, this together should be avoided. And explain the person regarding the muscle symptoms. And as soon as the person gets a muscle symptom, look for CPK. And if CPK is elevated more than 10 times the upper limit, means more than almost we say 400. So you should think of muscle complication and you should stop those drugs. There is one alternative which is called choline phenofibrates, which is the only phenofibrate that do not require activation from liver. So this particular phenofibrate is being utilized. There is also micronized phenofibrate which are available, which will be nanoparticles of phenofibrate, which will reduce the chance of muscle toxicity or muscle complications and can be taken with or without food. But as far as the Indian dyslipidemia guidelines in 2014, it is the only preparation of phenofibric acid recommended for use at present, and particularly it is a choline phenofibrates. Another alternative is nanoparticles phenofibrate can be utilized, but choline phenofibrate is the best. Another compound, niacin, which is very commonly being utilized, which is acting in the liver, and it will give rise to some complications, particularly cutaneous symptoms, particularly vasodilatation, flushing of the face. It can increase the chance of acute gout, means it increases the uric acid level, and it can also elevate the glycemic control. So it can elevate your glucose level. It can also have new onset of atrial fibrillation and person can have a little amount of weight loss. So all this you have to keep it in mind. It is also likely to produce little amount of elevation of SGPT. So if there is much more elevation, you will have to consider reducing the dose of niacin or stopping the dose of niacin. So liver, sugar level, and uric acid level, you must keep it in mind. So liver studies, sugar or HbA1c, uric acid level at a regular interval should be done. So always start at a low dose to prevent all these side effects. Niacin is taken with food or with aspirin. By and large, the dose to be started is 500 milligram. Maximum dose is 2000 milligram in a sustained release preparation. But as far as possible, don't go to 2000. It will produce more side effects. It will decrease LDL by very small percentage, that is 5 to 25. LDL increase is by 15 to 35, we say 15 to 20%, and TG will be reduced again by 20 to 50%. So it is more effective for TG and elevation of HDL. So it is by and large utilized as add-on therapy in place of elevation of HDL and lowering of TG. So it is utilized as a fourth drug. So first drug is statin, second drug is ezetimibe, which is very frequently utilized for lowering LDL, and phenofibrates is utilized to lower TG more as compared to elevation of HDL and lowering of LDL. So these are the four drugs we have discussed. This is how it acts. TG synthesis, this is normal in liver. So it will reduce the conversion of VLDL into LDL, and that is how it will be acting. Bile sequestrum, not commonly being utilized. The common side effect is GI side effects, constipation, decreased absorption of other drugs because of bile sequestrum. It will give rise to dyslipoproteinemia, will be bad, and it will elevate TG. So especially the person who has got an elevated TG, it should not be used. It can reduce a little amount of LDL. It can elevate HDL to only very, very small percentage. So mainly it is for increased TG only. So mainly utilized for increased TG level. Major action. Sorry. It may increase the TG level because it will prevent the absorption. May increase the TG level. So do keep it in mind. So mainly it is utilized for LDL reduction. By and large, it is not utilized. So it will be acting on a what we call as a enterohepatic circulations. So by and large, not commonly being utilized. As far as non-statin therapy is concerned, omega-3 fatty acids, but you will have to give in a larger dose. It will help in reduction of TG by 45%. HDL increase is very small, only by 9%. And increase in LDL by 44%. So because of this particular side effects, it is not very commonly being utilized. So in summary, for pure hypertriglyceridemia, phenofibrates, fish oil, niacin, common. For hypercholesterolemia, statin, add-on therapy, ezetimibe. Bile sequestrum, maybe, but by and large, these two first, statin with or without ezetimibe as an add-on therapy. And when it is mixed, statin plus phenofibrate, or you can go for statin with ezetimibe and you add on niacin, permutation combination. So pure LDL elevation, first drug of choice, statin, and then you can add. By and large, the common drug now which is being utilized is ezetimibe. And then you can use phenofibrate. Phenofibrate, by and large, if TG is high. Bile acid sequestrum, not commonly being utilized. Niacin is the another drug. If TG is high, first drug is phenofibrate. But by and large, phenofibrate alone is not utilized. It is always in combination with statin. Low dose of statin and low dose of phenofibrates. Combine LDL with TG, statin plus phenofibrate at step. And then you can add niacin. HDL along with drugs, exercise, etc. Niacin will be the drug of choice. And second will be phenofibrate. So combining together, high level of LDL, statin, add on ezetimibe. But side effects, myopathy. For high TG, phenofibrate is a drug, but never alone. By and large, with statin. And niacin may be added. Remarks, decrease carbohydrate intake. HDL, if it is low, niacin will be the first choice. Add-on therapy will be phenofibrate. But exercise will be the best way of elevating HDL. If LDL plus TG, statin plus fibrate. Niacin, add-on therapy, but myopathy at high risk. LDL with low HDL, statin with niacin, add-on therapy, phenofibrate. Exercise is a must for elevation of HDL. TG with HDL, again exercise is a must. And we commonly phenofibrate with niacin and you combine with statin. Indirectly, if you get two things together, statin with niacin and phenofibrate. This is a good combination. But for reduction of LDL, statin with ezetimibe. If all three are there, LDL high, TG high, HDL low, so statin with fenofibrate, and then you can go for ezetimibe, niacin, etc. But whenever you combine statin with fenofibrate, the chance of myopathy will be high. Even combination of statin with ezetimibe, myopathy chance will be high. So do keep that thing in mind. For additional risk factors like homocysteine, folic acid is a choice. Small dense lipoproteins, statin with fenofibrate. Lipoprotein A being elevated, niacin. Phenotype B, yet no drug has been advised. But what we call is a lifestyle modification with good exercise is a must. If person has come with a high TG pancreatitis, there are good number of other things which you will have to do. Aggressive fluid resuscitation, analgesic, nail by mouth, insulin infusion, heparin, plasmapheresis, and as far as the lipid lowering drugs, fenofibrate with omega-3 fatty acids will be a choice. During pregnancy, almost same like any other person, but here, fenofibrate and omega-3 fatty acids will reduce the risk of recurrent pancreatitis in case of pregnancy. Treatment does not differ in pregnancy from other people. Complications are quite common during pregnancy if a person develops acute pancreatitis. So you will have to treat accordingly. But there will be an additional chance of preeclampsia or eclampsia or HELLP syndrome will be much common in a person with a high triglycerides. There is another drug which is being very commonly being utilized. It is called icosapentethyl, which is icosapentoic acid, short form it is called EPA, which is combined good number of time with omega-3 fatty acids, and it is being utilized in a high risk groups, particularly the person with a high TG. So that is one of the drug. CETP inhibitors is called cholesterol ester transfer protein inhibitors, and these are the drugs to be utilized as the person who are at very high risk groups. There is another compound we call PCSK9 inhibitors. This is another compound which is a must for the person where you want to reduce the LDL to 55. Good number of time it is, we call very, very high risk groups of people. In that it will be utilized. There are other compounds like apolipoprotein B synthesis inhibitors, MTP inhibitors, all called microsomal triglyceride transfer protein inhibitors, etc. There are thyroid hormone analogs which are being tried, and there are many more drugs to be in market in the pipelines. This is PCKS9 monoclonal antibodies which are very frequently being utilized, particularly in a person where you want to reduce LDL to 70% of the baseline. In those particular group, you might have to add on the top of statin therapies, particularly in a very, very high risk groups of people. Now we are going to the guidelines. Guidelines are for guidance only, and they are always for confusing a person. But still we are mentioning, you have to treat according to the patient's conditions and according to the risk factors. There are a lot of guidelines which have started right from ATP3, ATP4, then 2013 guidelines, 2014, 2016, 2016, then again 2017. Now we have got 2019, we have got even Indian guidelines also. So we have got 2019, we have got Indian guidelines which were, there are Canadian and European guidelines which has been published in 2019, and there will be many more to come. This is one case just out of way, a 50-year known patient of complicated type 2 diabetes since 8 years, past history of anterior stemis means already he has got a damage to the coronary artery, that is stemi, 2 months back. Was put on atorvastatin 40 mg daily, and LDL was 160, which is still high according to the guidelines. After 2 months, the person CPK is elevated. You can see CPK is elevated, 456. Then LDL is still 110. So that is also not to the target. So person is referred for the management. Now you know that this is a muscle problem has started. So you cannot give this in a higher dose. You want to lower LDL even less than 110. You have to go to the target level. So you will have to utilize other drugs other than statins. So we always utilize this. So person at present is on statin. You will have to go to other groups of drugs. But simultaneously, you have to treat with aspirin, ACE inhibitor, etc. should be utilized. So you will be going to what we call as a non-statin therapies. So ABCD approach is utilized. We already mentioned all these things. Diet, exercise and drug is a must. So now you have to select in a drug. So we'll be going through those particular things. In a diet, by and large, always it is said that when you use saturated fatty acids, you can reduce by 8 to 10%. If you reduce the dietary cholesterol less than 200 milligram per day, you can reduce LDL by 5%. Weight reduction by 10 pounds, or we roughly say 4 to 5 kg, you can reduce your LDL by 8. So these are some of the figures. If you use the plant sterols, you can reduce LDL by almost up to 15%. These are those different types of advices in a diet. Based is a good advice from a dietitian. They will give the good advice regarding your diet, regarding carbohydrate, fats, and other, that is protein and energy requirements. So overall dietary management is must, in which weight reduction, restrict fat intake, alcohol intake should be restricted, limit intake of sweets, increase fiber intakes, and increase fish consumption, particularly because it is containing those omega-3 fatty acids, etc. Eat more fibers. You should be aware of your different types of fats. And they say smart protein, which helps to reduce your fat level. And low carbohydrate diet. These are all the different advices which are being there. So these are all the different materials which you control in your diet. And that is called lifestyle modification or total lifestyle modification by dietary recommendation. And depending upon that lifestyle modification, you can improve platelet activity, decrease LDL, increase HDL, and increase antioxidants by changing in the lifestyle modification, that is diet and exercise. You can decrease your blood pressure, homocysteine level, etc. Stop smoking. Then you can utilize different foods. You should be aware of which compound is more in what you are eating. So fiber, MUFA, PUFA, etc. There's a very nice discussion between. Yes. That is Mr. Modi. Is it true that there are 4 billion lazy people in India? So our Honorable Prime Minister answered, yes. That is why he started with a yoga day. So that is the importance, that regular exercise is a must. So by dietary intake, or we call good lifestyle modification, aerobic exercise will promote weight loss and it will also increase HDL. If you stop smoking, it will also increase your HDL. As well as if you improve your glycemic control, you reduce your blood pressure and you increase your HDL, it gives additional benefits. So weight loss, dietary benefits, physical activity, pharmacotherapy, behavior therapy, etc. will give all this benefit, increase in HDL, good glycemic control and reduction in blood pressure. And also restriction, or we call stopping smoking, will also help in increasing HDL and improve the endothelial dysfunction. Now there are certain guidelines which were there. So they have divided into four big groups. It is called atherosclerotic cardiovascular dysfunction. So ASCVD groups. Second group was where there is a very high level of, there is no primary atherosclerotic complications, but person is having high LDL, more than 190, and age is between 20 to 75. And third group was primary prevention in a diabetic groups and primary prevention in a non-diabetic groups. By calculating high risk score for 10 years period. This was the four group which were there. Clinical ASCVD, without ACVD, atherosclerotic cardiovascular complication, with hyperlipidemia, diabetic person and non-diabetic person. So these were the four groups. But this particular things has changed now. So now there are recent guidelines which are coming and which are now applicable. So statin is indicated in any person who has got a high level of LDL, with diabetic person, age more than 40 years, or age 30 and diabetic more than 15 years duration with microvascular complications, or if a person has got CKD where age is more than 50, GFR is reduced, etc. So this group also statin you will have to decide. But if the person develops a CKD, you will have to adjust the dose of statin. In atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease like myocardial infarction, acute coronary syndrome, stable angina, documented coronary artery disease by angiography, stroke, TIA, all this will be what we call as secondary prevention. While in this group will be primary prevention. So peripheral arterial disease where ABI index is less than 0.9, abdominal aortic aneurysm, etc. These are all we call complication because of atherosclerosis. So in this, it will be secondary prevention, while this will be primary prevention groups. And in India, we have got a high chance of coronary artery disease as well as cardiovascular disorders because we have got high atherogenic dyslipidemias. We have got traditional risk factors. Some of them are very, very common in Indians. We have got a central obesity. We have got a risk factor at a younger age groups. In India, we have got a lower control rates of hypertension, hyperlipidemia, diabetes, smoking, etc. are less controlled as compared to other people's. And we are poorly aware of cardiovascular complication and primordial prevention. Dietary pattern, we don't follow strictly. So all these are very, very high chance of getting atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. So because of that particular thing, the risk of death is very, very high. Almost 68% of the death are due to cardiovascular complications. Stroke is 2 to 4 times higher than other people. Heart failure is 2 to 5 times higher than other people. And risk of death from atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications are 2 to 4 times higher than normal person. Hence, we should be more aware in India. Normally, there is a slightly elevated LDL, while in India, we have got a high TG, low HDL, and we have got a high prevalence of small density lipoprotein particles. This is all highly atherogenic. So it is said that however westernized we get, Indians are still Indians, but these are what we call as a fast foods, very well known to produce all those things. So there is a justification of lowering an LDL in Indians. These are all those factors which justifies that we should treat rigidly in Indians. So at your leisure, you can go through. Like heart disease, 10 years earlier than Americans. Approximately 25% of those die because of the coronary artery disease are less than 40 years. Then lowering of LDL to a less than 30 milligram leads to further reduction in the cardiac event is very well known. There is a guideline which has been published in 2019. We have got this risk factor, high TG, low HDL, high level of lipoprotein A. We have got ratio being abnormal. We have got an increased level of a small dense lipoproteins, etc. in Indians. These are all high risk for atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications. So at the first visit only, you should try to find out whether he is having a low risk, moderate risk or high risk. By and large, we say low risk where there is only one risk factor, while moderate is more than two major risk factor, and high risk are three major risk factor. So that is how you try to identify those groups into three groups: low risk, moderate risk, high risk. And then we also put one more group is very high risk, where there is already pre-existing atherosclerotic cardiovascular disorders, or person is diabetic with more than two major risk factors, or person is having a familial hypercholesterolemia or familial hypertriglyceridemia. This should be kept in mind. And depending upon those complication, you should decide regarding the treatment part of it. So we divide them into different groups like low risk, moderate risk, high risk, very high risk. At your leisure time, these are the two dangerous groups. We should try to identify whether they belong to any one of these groups. These people will require a rigid control. While in a low risk, you will have to calculate the risk score and then decide what dose to be given and what should be your target. And in moderate risk also, you will have to calculate the score and then you will have to decide the target. So less than 1 is low risk, between 1 to 5% moderate risk, between 5 to 10 high risk, and if the score goes above 10, it is considered as a very high risk. And for this, there are special scores which are being utilized. So you can utilize different type of scores and try to find out the accuracy of those scores. So for different risk factors, there are certain targets and goals which are being decided. We'll be going through those particular targets as we come across. So regarding smoking, diet, physical exercise, body weight reduction, blood pressure, LDL level, non-HDL level, apoprotein lipid level, triglyceride level, diabetes control, etc. All this, not only LDL, HDL and apolipoproteins and TG. It should be associated with smoking restriction, dietary control, a regular physical exercise, body weight reduction, blood pressure control, rigid control of diabetes with lipid controls and lipid targets. We'll be talking more of a lipid targets. So this is what has been revised and published in 2020 by Lipid Association of India. In short, we call as LAI. So it is a Lipid Association of India which has recommended, and he has divided into three groups: major risk factors, these are high risk factors, and these are moderate risk factors. And depending upon that groups, these are major risk. So if person is having all these risk factors like age more than 45 in male and in female 55 years, family history of premature atherosclerotic complication, cigarette smoking, high blood pressure and low HDL, these are considered as major risk. Other high risk factors are all these factors. At your leisure time, you can go through like diabetes with one major risk, CKD, then familial hypercholesterolemia, that is we call familial or genetic, then coronary calcium score, single risk factor, non-stenotic carotid plaques, lipoprotein A level more than 50, all this will be again a high risk groups. Moderate risk group, coronary artery calcium score, carotid intima media thickness, then lipoprotein less than 50, metabolic syndrome, apolipoprotein more than 110, and HRCP, we call highly sensitive, HSCRP, more than 2. These are moderate risk. So after calculating all this, you put them into a low risk, moderate risk, high risk, very high risk, and extreme risk. So in low risk, where your risk score, your major this groups is less than 1. So that is low risk group. And we keep LDL level at 100. If it is moderate risk, less than 100. In a high risk, less than 50. In a very high risk, now they go even below 50. They have gone up to 30. So these are the different targets now which are being set up. And whenever you want to reach to this target, by statin, it is extremely difficult. Then you will have to add ezetimibe and then PCSK9 inhibitors will be utilized. So that is what is being there. So now they also use the term primary prevention before this particular things happens. That is atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications. So before that occurs, we'll call that as a primary prevention. So in that primary prevention, low risk, moderate risk, high risk, and very high risk. So target is here for low risk, less than 130. Moderate risk, less than 100. High risk, less than 70. Very high risk, less than 50. And even now they have come down to 55. That is 230. And in secondary prevention, particularly in a high risk group, directly straightforward to now they have come down to 50. And in a very, very high risk group, extreme risk groups, as much as less than even 30. Very difficult, but still you try. So now they say that if you bring it down to 116 in a low risk groups, it is beneficial. In moderate risk group, 100. In a high risk group, 70. In a very high risk group, 55. And now they say that very, very high risk group, up to 30. They have come down to 30. So those are the different things. You can see here, this is a comparison of different risk groups. This is a treatment goal and this is a recommended drug therapy. So this is a goal for LDL and this is a goal for non-HDL. And you will have to go for a drug therapy. At what level you go for and how much to reduce. That is, this is LDL reduction in an extreme risk group A and B. You can see here in B group, you have to reduce LDL to 30 and you have to decrease LDL, that is non-HDL to 60. So that is how you go for. So either you utilize non-HDL criteria or you utilize LDL criteria. So in a low risk group, we go up to 130 and here 100. While here you can see that non-HDL, you bring it down to 130 and LDL to 100. So that is the treatment goal. So depending upon that, what you are using. This is for primary prevention and this is for secondary prevention. I'll just brush up. Primary prevention means the person has not developed atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications. And there it is divided into three groups. Age between less than 20, between 20 to 40 and more than 40, but less than 75. And then depending upon the LDL level and estimated risk factors, etc., you will put them into a group. Low risk, borderline risk, intermediate risk and high risk. So after doing that, means no evidence of atherosclerotic complications. You consider the age, particularly in the person with the age of 40 to 75, and LDL is between 70 to 190. Now you are calculated the risk score, and after calculating the risk score, you are putting them into five groups: low risk, borderline risk, that is low risk means less than 5% risk for 10 years. Between 5 to 75 is what we call as a borderline risk. 7.5 to less than 20, intermediate risk. And more than 20, it is put into high risk, where you will try to reduce your LDL by more than 50%. And this will be by high statin therapy. While here, you will require a low statin therapy. And here, you will require moderate statin therapy. So depending upon how much reduction you want, accordingly, it is being revised. So this is with LDL 190. This is with diabetes mellitus. And this is without diabetes mellitus. So you have to decide according to those criterias and set up the target. And this was published by American College of Cardiology in 2019. And this is secondary prevention, where already clinically there is an complications which are being there. Healthy lifestyle is a must for primary as well as secondary. Now, if a person is not at a very high risk, then we look at the age less than 75. You go for high intensity therapy. And then if age is more than 75, depending upon the risk factor, you will decide regarding high intensity or moderate intensity and how much to reduce. And you will decide regarding the targets. If a person is having atherosclerotic complication and he is at a very high risk, then he requires a high intensity therapy. And then you might have to add ezetimibe. And then if you don't reach the target, then PCSK9 inhibitors should be utilized. So these are some of the things which will be required in secondary prevention. So that has been highlighted further, this particular what we call as intensification of approach to the patient with atherosclerotic cardiovascular complication. It is this group. So here even TG is being added. And if the person has got a high TG level, you will have to consider those what we call as a non-statin therapy. And this is with LDL high and HDL low. In those, you might have to, if you don't reach the target, you might have to add ezetimibe followed by PCSK9 inhibitors. So that is the importance. This is for type 1, type 2 means what we call as person with atherosclerotic complication, person without atherosclerotic complications. And this is in general, if you want to achieve the LDL targets, what steps you take. At your leisure time, you can go through just in a brief. First, full dose of statin. Go to the highest level, that is we call as 80 milligram of atorvastatin or 40 milligram of rosuvastatin. If not controlled and if the person can tolerate, now you can add ezetimibe, 10 milligram only. And if still not controlled, you don't reach the target, then you can add PCSK9 inhibitors. That is roughly the entire idea of this. So statin, if you don't reach the targets, statin plus ezetimibe. If you don't reach the target, you can add bempedoic acid. Particularly if you don't want to use those PCSK9 inhibitors because they are in injectable forms. So you will have to give those injections at every 3 months at a 90 days interval. So if you want to avoid that, you can use this. So these are all the different guidelines for person between 40 to 75 of age without diabetes mellitus and 10-year risk course is between 7.9 to 19.9. We already mentioned intermediate risk score, little more in detail. This is for secondary prevention, high risk conditions, and you will have to meet the targets. These are all high risk groups. And person is already having a atherosclerotic complication. Now you are going for secondary prevention. So now these are all the conditions where the person is already having a complication, and this will be all secondary prevention. Means patient who are for PCI, primary prevention has failed, or patient with a low HDL level, patient with a CKD, patient with impaired glucose tolerance, statin intolerance, etc. And patient with ASCVD, with all this, you will go for secondary prevention. Now, in summary, we have mentioned some of the conditions. Say if a person is there with a atherosclerotic complication, atorvastatin is a must. Undergoing PCI, either atorvastatin or rosuvastatin. Person for prevention of a cardiovascular cerebrovascular disorders. For diabetes mellitus, atorvastatin. Person in whom you want to elevate the HDL level, you will have to add pitavastatin or you will use rosuvastatin. In CKD, atorvastatin you can utilize or you can use pitavastatin. Patient with a very high LDL level, rosuvastatin is little over about atorvastatin. If a person has got IGT, impaired glucose tolerance, and high CVD risk score, pitavastatin is preferred over rosuva and atorva. If person has got a statin intolerance, pitavastatin is replaced for atorva or rosuvastatin. And if there is an atherogenetic misdyslipidemia with type 2, then with statin you add seroclitazas, which are PPAR gamma activator inhibitors. Or if person has got more of TG, you can add fenofibrates. So these are the two combinations. You can just remember those. So baseline, first drug of choice, you will always start with either fluvastatin, lovastatin, simvastatin, pravastatin or pitavastatin. But still, for even low intensity, atorvastatin is preferred, 10 mg to 20 mg. For moderate intensity, you have to reduce LDL from the baseline by 30 to 50%. In low intensity, you have to reduce by 30% from the baseline. And in a high intensity, you will go to 40 to 80 milligram of atorvastatin or rosuvastatin 20 to 40 milligram. And you will reduce LDL more than 50%. And then still, if you require more, in case of a very high risk group with atherosclerotic complications who are belonging to high risk group, you will have to add ezetimibe or PCSK inhibitors. So, in a high intensity, mainly atorvastatin and rosuvastatin are utilized. In moderate, you can utilize any, but by and large, again, atorvastatin and rosuvastatin are preferred, except pitavastatin is preferred in a person with intolerance and in case of a CKD. Low intensity, by and large, good number of, we are using atorvastatin and rosuvastatin, but you can use simvastatin or you can use lovastatin or pravastatin, etc. In CKD, in state 2, where your GFR is between 60 to 90, you will prefer any one of this. But if the GFR is reduced between 60 to 50, that is state 3 and 4, in atorvastatin, you don't have to reduce the dose, and also in case of a provastatin. But for rosuvastatin, you will have to reduce 5 mg once a daily to start, and then you should not exceed 10 mg. So rosuvastatin will be contraindicated in CKD. While less than 15, you can see that reduction in atorvastatin is usually not. You don't have to reduce. Adjust the dose, none. And for pravastatin, so the drug of choice in a CKD will be atorvastatin and pravastatin. These two will be the drug of choice. Now, there are some drugs which can have interactions like amiodarone, amlodipine, digoxin, diltiazine, etc. will have an interaction with these statins. That should be kept in mind. follow-up monitoring is absolutely necessary. Liver panels should be done because statin will produce elevation of liver enzymes and can produce hepatotoxicity. So liver panels should be repeated every 4 weeks or 12 weeks. And after that, you can repeat every yearly. And depending upon the clinical indications. So you have to decide regarding the reduction of the LDL goals and person with atherosclerotic cardiovascular complications, whether he is in a very high risk group or he is in a moderate groups, etc. You have to decide the target, and depending upon the statin side effects, you will have to decrease the dose or increase the dose depending upon your LDL targets. So do keep that in mind. So monitoring and follow-up is a must for LDL targets and side effects, particularly muscle and liver. There is very rarely this will be one of the therapy which was being utilized, that is lipid apheresis, but not very effective. Now there are some drugs which can increase the LDL level. They are under trial. So you can utilize, that is what we call as a PCSK inhibitors and CETP inhibitors. Now there are search of vaccines, etc. also. In near future, we might have a vaccine for control of lipids. So I end my lecture here. Thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable, and I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me. This is a very, very useful topic. You will come across in your everyday practice, each and every person will be having some amount of something concerned with your lipids. Because as the age advances, you will have a lipid disorders. We call dyslipidemias. And you will have a complication secondary due to diabetes, hypertension, liver disorders, kidney disorders, etc. So almost all person will require something here and there. If you like this particular lecture, please don't forget to press button like, subscribe, and you can share with your friends. And you can also give suggestions so that I can improve. See you in next lecture.